Welcome to the mobile security session. In this session, the topics we'd like to cover are some information about authentication and how we log in and what the login and request sequences look like so that we can always validate and make sure that the right users are logged in at the right time. So we want to make sure you are who you say you are in authentication and that you get then authorized to view what you're supposed to be able to do. And that is based on roles, so we have role-based authorization, and that includes both from the server side and the client side. So on the client side there is role-based authorization, and we want to make sure that people can be authorized to get to some of the global endpoints that are providing the data as well. So this will make more sense as we go into a little more detail. So let's start with the authentication side. When we go to log in from a device-specific perspective, we either can do persistent logins or session logins. A persistent login will be the typical way to authenticate, and basically that means that the user is logged in until they decide to log out. By default, the persistent login time is going to be 365 days. So they'll be logged in for a year, and then they'll get logged out. But if they don't log out and they keep the app open, then they would be logged in for that whole time. Now, there isn't any conversation if the app is closed. There are no communications to the server. So it's not as if this is going to be a problem, but it's there. There's also something that we can set up called session login, which is what we would be more used to from a web application perspective. And this would be used when we have more secure use cases. So if we're doing banking or we have some sort of sensitive information, then we want to log in, and we'll be logging in for a session. And the authentication is lost whenever the application is closed. Here the logins will be much shorter, and any kind of change to the application as far as it being closed, potentially going offline, you may get logged out because of those types of interactions. So if we look at the login sequence in some detail, from the client perspective, if we go to login, the login information will be sent to the server. The server checks the database and creates the login information. And basically says, okay, we know who you are, and we're going to go ahead and cache that information on our side, create some cookies, and respond back with those cookies so that from this point on we know who you are as far as a client to the server. So we know their information, we create the cookies that we need, and that helps make sure that we know they're authenticated and makes the following interactions a little bit quicker. Now there is an HTTP only cookie, and it has the login information, time until it needs to be updated, as well as the expiration date, and a hash method authentication code that sort of keeps track of our session and what's going on from that perspective. So this is a cookie that the server cares about, and we'll be sending it to the server each time we need it. There's also a client accessible cookie, and this will have information for both the client side and the server side. So it has the cross-site request forgery token inside of it, and it will keep track of the user ID and the user name of the person whose device or client is actually the one that is available. So once we've gone through the login procedure, then we're going to make a request. And when we make a request, the server is going to check our signature. And the signature is actually the information between some of the information out of both of those cookies that we just discussed, and it will check the signature. If anything was in the cache and isn't there, it may need to go retrieve the information again. The security cache may have lost some of the information due to either timeouts or size. But once we get the information checked and we have all the information that's correct, then we can go back and say, yes, we can give you the response. So we will continually be checking to make sure you are who you say you are when we go back and respond with the types of information that we're looking for. Now, when we say that we're going to be checking the signature, what's really happening is we check the HMAC field that was generated by the server, and that will make sure that we know who you are, and that key and what gets generated is on a per environment basis. So that would be different if you had to connect to different servers. It's also going to check all of that signature data that we mentioned, and that uses information out of both cookies. So it's going to look at information like the login ID, time until update, as well as the expiration date, the user ID, the username, and the cross-site stuff. So checking all of this makes sure that our mobile applications are secure and that you are really the person who should be interacting with the server. Now, we have both of these cookies. When the cookie information comes over, it will get checked for authenticity and for validity. If for some reason it looks as if the cookie has been manipulated or tampered with, the user will automatically be anonymous, or anonymized in this case. So if the cookie expires or it looks like the cookie has been tampered with, then we'll go ahead and anonymize the user and force them to go ahead and log in again. So the devices will delete the cookies after their expiration date, so there may come a time where the request is sent and the cookie isn't there. And if the cookie isn't there, then obviously we'll have to log in and get the authentication information again so the cookie can be regenerated. Now, there are configuration or configurable expiration parameters, and you can see that in this particular case we mentioned that there's the persistent login. So the persistent login cookie expiration is set to that 1 year time frame. There's also a persistent max idle time. And what that means is, should we go ahead and basically expire the cookie if you don't communicate to the server within a certain amount of time. So even though the cookie won't expire for a year, if you don't come in and use it at least once a month, then we may go ahead and expire it anyway. So if the max idle time is 1 month, then we could go ahead and check that. There is the session cookie, and that max idle time in minutes will go ahead and do the same thing, but on the minute level, not in the days level. And then for the mobile login, we mentioned that it will go ahead and look up our information each time we go to be authenticated. So when we log in, it checks that and caches that information. How long it will cache that information is set on the server side, so the cache will hold on to our information for a certain amount of time before it has to go back and check again. So all of these are configurable to make sure that we can kind of get the type of security and the performance out of the security system that we're looking for. After authentication, there is authorization. So when we think about, okay, we know who you are, what are you allowed to get to? Screen roles enforce the access control for screens and for server endpoints. So when we're calling for new data and we call the server and we're trying to get the information from the RESTful endpoints, the type of endpoints that get generated, any of our aggregates will be generating endpoints. All of our server actions that get used by client actions will have endpoints. Server actions that get used indirectly by the screen, and any kind of data or logic that might be contained in blocks that are used by the screen. So it doesn't have to be directly attached to the screen, it can be a block that is in the screen. But all of these server endpoints will have access control, and the access control for those endpoints is enforced by the server. So when we communicate to the server and we're looking for this type of action, it will decide whether or not we have the capability and the authorization to get that information back. So, what happens if I'm offline and I want to control what screens I can see or other types of things? Well, the user's roles are stored in local storage at login and at logout. So this will allow us, even if we're offline, to go ahead and decide which types of screens a particular user could see or not see. You don't want to have to use this too much because it could be tampered with. Unless we try to encrypt local storage or do something else, people could change that. So the check should only be there for UI purposes, and this isn't something that we'd want to use too often. Now, role validation will be checked upon navigation in between different types of screens. So we can put access control on the UI and enforcing that without having to go to the server. Even when we're connected to the server, we don't have to check with it. We can actually do that check locally. And again, as I mentioned, that will mean that it's available offline. If for some reason we can't get to that particular screen, it will raise a security exception. Exceptions on the client side can be handled in multiple ways. We can either redirect to a different screen and say, sorry, you don't have access to that screen, or we can remain in the original screen and sort of do nothing and just not tell someone that, hey, there is something else there, but you don't have access to it. So a couple different ways that can be handled. Now, when we think about endpoints that are exposed to the rest of the world as APIs, we mentioned that all of those things like the aggregates to get data, the different types of server actions are all going to generate endpoints. There isn't any one single place to see all of these, and that makes it a little bit difficult to kind of see what the overall set of endpoints and what the total set of APIs that we're making available are. So from a security standpoint, we can't really see how many things we're having to secure. And this is especially true of what we might call the flowless actions. So if we put an aggregate on a screen, or if we're using entity actions directly, or some type of integrations that are in a client flow, there is no easy way to see where those things are. And the thing that's important there is we also can't say exactly how those flowless actions, how is the aggregate being secured. Well, for all of those global endpoints, the endpoints will be secured by the block or the screen that it is going to go ahead and be part of. Now, sometimes those global endpoints will be used in multiple places. So if we have a block and the block is used on four screens, the authorization for how that block is used could be different on each screen. And the server will know how to enforce the authorization for all of that. But when we go to a global endpoint directly, when we first try to get to it, that global endpoint will end up having the minimum security level and then be checking after that for who that person is. So this means that if we're making some sort of endpoint available for use in one of the screens and that screen or block has no security, then it's basically open to be called whenever it needs to. So it is always the least restrictive screen that is going to be dictating how it is exposed, and we really want to be careful when we're doing that, because that sort of creates a potential security flaw if that screen does have access to some more sensitive information. So understanding the APIs and what is being authorized and exposed is very important. So in this session we talked about authentication, the login sequence, and how you can look at the different types of information and control and configure how often you'll need to validate and expire those types of authentications. From an authorization standpoint, we did mention that role-based authorization exists, as well as just on the client side, and that we do have authorization set for global endpoints, but for shared global endpoints the security might be a little bit less than what the most restrictive needs, because it will always be the least restrictive that is there. So this is only a quick overview. There's a lot of information about this, and you should probably do some more research on this and get the details so that you feel comfortable. But at this point you have a good introduction to begin doing a deeper dive into the subject.